we want to find the domain and range for each radical function. To review, the domain is a set of all possible inputs, or x values, and the range is a set of all possible outputs, which would be the y values or function values. Notice f of x is a square root function, so the index is 2. G of x is a cube root function, so the index is 3. And h of x is a fourth root function, so the index is 4. Determining whether the index is odd or even helps us determine the domain and range of the radical function. So for example, if we have a radical function in the form f of x equals the principal nth root of x, if the index n is even, then the radicand, or the expression underneath the square root, has to be greater than or equal to 0, meaning the radicand has to be non-negative. And if the radicand is non-negative, then the function values, or the y values, will always be greater than or equal to 0. But if n is odd, then the radicand, or x, can be any real number. And if the radicand can be positive, negative, or 0, that means the function values would also be any real number. So going back to our three examples, since f of x is equal to the principal square root of 2 minus x, a radicand, 2 minus x, must be greater than or equal to 0. So if we set this up as an inequality, we would have 2 minus x must be greater than or equal to 0. And now we can solve for x to determine the domain of the function. So we'll subtract 2 on both sides. That would give us negative x is greater than or equal to negative 2. Now to solve for x, we'll divide both sides by negative 1. But remember, when solving an inequality, if we multiply or divide by a negative, we have to reverse the inequality symbol. So this would give us x is less than or equal to positive 2, which would be the domain of the given function. So we'll write this using inequalities, and we'll also write this using interval notation. So if x is less than or equal to positive 2, using interval notation, we'd have the interval from negative infinity to positive 2, close on positive 2. So these square brackets indicate that 2 is included in this interval. And then for the range of the possible function values, if we're taking the principal square root of a non-negative number, then the function values would also be non-negative, meaning that y will always be greater than or equal to 0. Or using interval notation, the interval closed on 0 to positive infinity. Now to verify the domain and range, let's go ahead and graph the given function. So here's the graph of f of x. To verify the domain, we'll project this graph onto the x-axis. Notice the largest x value is positive 2, and then we can see x is going to be less than or equal to positive 2 along the x-axis, so this verifies our domain. Then to verify the range, if we project this onto the y-axis, notice the smallest y value is 0, and then the graph moves up from here, so the range would be when y is greater than or equal to 0. So this graph does verify our domain and range are correct. Now looking at g of x, because we have the principal cube root, or the index is odd, x minus 1 can be any real number. And if x minus 1 can be any real number, then so can x. So the domain would be all real numbers. We're using interval notation. We'd have the interval from negative infinity to positive infinity. So if we take the cube root of positive and negative real numbers, as well as 0, the function values for g of x would also be positive, negative, or 0, and therefore the range is also all real numbers. So again, using interval notation, we'd have the interval from negative infinity to positive infinity. Again, we'll go ahead and graph this function to verify the domain and range. Here's a graph of g of x. Notice if we project this onto the x-axis, there's no holes or breaks, and the x values would be from negative infinity to positive infinity because the graph moves right and left indefinitely. If we project this onto the y-axis to verify the range, even though the graph is moving right very quickly and left very quickly, it is also moving upward and downward without any breaks, and therefore the range would also be our real numbers. Now for the last function, we have h of x equals the fourth root of 4x plus 12. And because the index is even, our radicand, 4x plus 12, must be greater than or equal to 0. So we'll go ahead and solve for x. We'll subtract 12 on both sides. Divide by 4. So we have x is greater than or equal to negative 3, which would be the domain of our function. Using interval notation, we'd have the interval closed on negative 3 to positive infinity. And if we're taking the fourth root of a non-negative number, the function values would also be non-negative, and therefore the range is y greater than or equal to 0. Or using interval notation, the interval from 0 to infinity closed on 0. And again, we'll verify this by graphing the function. Here's the graph of h of x. To verify the domain, if we project this onto the x-axis, notice the smallest x value is negative 3, and from there it moves to the right, so our domain would be x greater than or equal to negative 3. If we project this onto the y-axis, notice how the smallest y value is 0, and from here the graph moves upward, verifying our range is y greater than or equal to 0. Okay, that's going to do it for these three examples. I hope you found this explanation helpful.